other percentages are doing pretty well, right? Okay, so let's get started. My name is Ebin. I work as an agile coach in a bank called Society General. So today's topic is transformation versus adoption. The topic contains three major parts. One is about differentiating between adoption and transformation. And second part is about understanding the culture of a company, culture of a team, how that is related to your transformation. Last, maybe the least, is what we did with respect to the culture. Okay? So idea is to not present what we did completely, how our journey, what are the challenges we face. Instead, I would like to give you or generate some curiosity out of you, where you can probably go back and then think about the culture which you have in your company, in your project, and how can you tweak your way of doing things a little different so that it works, right? Okay. So this is something which I found.
So people get a lot of idea about different frameworks. Just before, in the lightning talk, our friend was talking about we choose frameworks because it's trendy, geeky, it's fancy, right? So many companies do transformation thinking that, okay, this is the way market is going, so we need to do agile. So they don't have a real need. They don't know what they really want. So they just catch on to the train and then say, we start doing things, right? So all, yeah, of course, there are use out of lot of different frameworks, but don't get obsessed with one framework which probably you thinking about solving all your problems. You may have to take different parts from each frameworks and then start making it work. You should basically understand how things happens in your company. If something works outside, doesn't mean that it's going to work as it is in your company, right? Sorry. So when we try to differentiate between adoption and transformation, anybody here have some idea about transformation and adoption? Anybody want to differentiate between transformation and adoption? Okay.
Mm-hmm. Transformation is moving to a new state, whereas adoption, you retain some of what is already there, take in some new stuff as well.
Okay.
Whereas transformation could mean that you are abandoning whatever you are currently having and moving to a totally new system.
Mm-hmm. Transformation for me is more like a journey, whereas adoption is more like a problem.
Okay, great. So we have some insight about transformation and adoption. We know that it's not same, right? But many people use it interchangeably, right? We do agile transformation, we do agile adoption, and we are agile, right? We see that. So one definition which I have found is, probably, no, not definition, one analogy is learning to make a decent coffee is adoption, but becoming a barista is kind of transformation. One more. Adoption will change what you do, but transformation will change you, the way you think. We talk about mindsets, right? We say, if you don't have agile mindset, nothing will sustain. We tried enough. Probably it's happening in your place also. I have been a coach for last 6 years. I never seen anywhere you have 100% agile mindset. So we go, we do adoption in companies, we get out, we'll see that things will be falling apart after some time. It's because we didn't really transform our mind. Yep. So many people talks about, you know, transforming, adopting, but nobody really care much about the mindset. Everybody want to talk about, we started doing stand-up meeting, we do retrospection, we do that, we do this, etc., etc. And we say, we call ourselves as agile. Even in our company, we have a certificate given to the team which start practicing agile, which is called, you are successfully completed the agile transformation, so you get a star, and they can paste it on their whiteboard and enjoy. But after 3 months, you go back to them, they have the star there. That's all, right? Especially in India, the main habit of middle managers are kind of shifting people because they are In Agile, they don't have much job, right? There are a Scrum Master who's going to take care of the team. He's going to enable, he's a servant leader, okay, all that fine. So what should I do? I'll find innovative ways of shuffling people. We keep shuffling people. So where do you get that unity? By the time they start collaborating, when they start forming a common mindset, we start shuffling them. Again, they have to go through the pattern again. So what to do? So first we have to admit that, yeah, we have a problem. If you think you don't have a problem, it's okay. But if you think, yes, we have a problem related to our Agile, because even earlier Sudipto was giving a talk here and he was telling that waterfall project also can adapt Agile. Of course, there are a lot of things which we can take to any projects for that matter, waterfall or V model, any cycle. What we can do is probably can say individual interaction is applicable everywhere. It doesn't matter whether you have to be Agile. You can be collaborative. You can be transparent. All right? So what happens is, if this has a direct connection with the culture of the company. If you don't manage the culture of the company, it starts managing you. So this is what we have realized, that when you say there is a culture difference, if the culture of the project or culture of the company is not really Agile friendly, what happens is you go do a transformation, or rather you go and teach them some tools, technique, etc., you exit, the culture will come, start managing them and come back to the square one. So I have job anyway. You go transform the team 1 year, next year anyway you have to go transform them again, because they come back, right? So Agile coaches can survive for some time. You agree? And there are a lot of people did a lot of study about this cultural influence on, so I'm not talking about culture between two different countries. Don't mistake that. Culture of the company I'm talking about, culture of the project. Each company, each project have a different culture. It's hard to believe, but it's the truth. So how do we find out? Let's look at that. So these are the culture which is being used as one of the model. So there is a book called Agile Survival Guide by Michael Sahota. So probably you can refer to that. It's a free book. You can go to InfoQ and search for it. You will get a lot of details. So this model is called Snyder model. So this is talking about companies which is people oriented and completely company oriented, and some reality oriented and possibility oriented. So in this plot, you will see majorly the culture is collaboration, control, competence, and cultivation. If your culture is completely control, you do any kind or you try any kind of transformation, probably it will come back because your culture is different. So you are not trying to, if you don't change the culture, it's a little difficult. So for example, nowadays if you look at a lot of famous Agile coaches, for example, Craig Larman. I used to work with Craig Larman. Nowadays he don't work with teams. He says no point working with the teams, rather let me work with the organization structure. If the organization is a control freak, then probably whatever you do down that small bubble, the development team, doesn't matter. They try to be transparent. Somebody use a hammer, right? No. Some people will say something, Agile, we bought Agile, we paid money to a coach, he came and did something, you got Agile, yeah, that's fine. But don't question me, don't challenge me, this is the way things works here. So if you want to understand the culture of your company or your project, ask a simple question, how do we do things around here? How do you succeed? Is it that the 2 weeks just before the release you go and tell everybody that nothing doing, don't go home, make it work? Or that you say, okay, probably we have a potential problem, we are going to slip the deadline, so shall we sit together and identify what are the challenges, let's communicate to the customer. So you can do it in multiple ways. The one which you do probably will define your culture. And your culture is not probably going to stick on to one single quadrant. It probably, you know, you may have two prominent cultures, right? So what do you think? Which are the culture which is conducive for Agile, for Scrum, basically? collaboration, only collaboration, cultivation and collaboration. Agree? Okay. What about control? No, we have answers for everything, right? There are some framework which we do more control, not Scrum. What is it? Your method, Kanban. Okay, so we probably have to debate, yeah. And about competence, what do we do to build the competence? No, okay, probably we'll go to the next slide. So as you mentioned, I tried to plot the Agile manifesto in this quadrants. So you see that cultivation and collaboration is the most apt thing for Scrum, which is spanning across here. And if you try to do a transformation in your team, in your project, you identify the culture, and if the culture is varying between collaboration and cultivation, then you don't need to worry about it. You start practicing Agile, it should sustain normally. Right? But if you have a controlled environment and if you start introducing Scrum there, it's not very easy. You're going to face a lot of challenges, a lot of resistance. Eventually, you don't know what the outcome is going to be. Yeah? When we talk about competence, nowadays I think many people are talking about continuous delivery, software craftsmanship. Yes? So when we talk about competence, there are the fifth potential item in the manifesto, that is the software craftsmanship over crafts coming into picture, where we do a lot of XP practices, we do TDD, BDD, we do clean code, pair programming, continuous integration, flexible architecture, just-in-time release. Yes? So when we get into any team, so practically what we can do is, so basically an Agile coach, in my perspective, when I go to a project, when I want to say, I meet people to just do some kind of transformation or adopt Agile, the first question will be whether you really want a transformation or adoption. Or rather, you can ask, what is your real problem? What do you want to do? Why do you want to do it? As our friend said, is it just because it's a fancy word now? Or if you really have a problem which you want to solve, your customer is really waiting to get releases every now and then, couple of times a day, once in a week, once in a month. There are projects which I worked, we transformed the team, or rather we introduced the concepts, the Agile ideas to a project, and they produce results in every iteration or features in every iteration, and the customer is not ready to take it. For them, it's a big pain to take releases every iteration. They want releases only in 6 months. Right, and they don't want to come every now and then and talk to the people and then give feedback. They say, no, we are not interested. We have some business to do here. So we really have to ask that question to the change agents, what do you really want? What do you really want to do? So, okay, there was a conference, a lot of people coming in, talking about Agile. Agile is the great thing. Many people think that, you know, Agile is a silver bullet, right? And even I was just talking to Sudipta also about this. Last 2 years, when we had the conferences, we were trying to kind of market Agile. We'll say that, yeah, Agile is the thing which we should go forward. A traditional waterfall approach is designed for constructing bridges, not for this kind of industry where we do empirical things. We can't estimate things. We don't know. It's so dynamic, changing every day. And now we hear many people talking about, no, you have to be very conscious about the culture. You don't have to be 100% Agile. You have to partially Agile. You take a couple of concepts and then you create your own framework. Of course, that's what everybody do. So far, I haven't seen not even a single team who is 100% Agile. I haven't. Probably I'm looking at wrong places. I worked with 5 different companies. So the main question for me is, when I go and then preach about a practice or a framework, I have to look back and see what are the improvements probably I can bring in, and who is going to get benefit out of it? Who have the system thinking? Who think the system as a whole? Is it that the new project manager want to prove himself and introduce some changes in the way we do things, and then say, okay, this is a trendy word, let's do it. Yeah? And you, if you are interested, you can actually refer to the book and you will get a lot of questions which probably will help you to identify what is the purpose. So when you say, okay, whatever we said, you agree with me, you go back, how do you do things? You understand your culture, fine. So what do we do about it? So you can frame a kind of assessment where you can ask some simple question. So you understand the company culture, number one. Again, the company culture may not be equal to the culture of the project. It can be vary. So you understand that, and then if possible, if you are flexible enough, if you are agile enough to form your framework within these limitations, probably you can make it better. I'm not guaranteeing that it's going to be a success, but it's obviously going to be better. When you have a controlled environment and when you apply Scrum there, it's very difficult to empower people. It's not a notion which they know. So what we did in our company, what we did was, it was a big change. When I joined the company, we started a center called Agile Center in our, one of the floors. We have a lot of Agile coaches sitting. We just go and coach Scrum. So whatever your problem, we have one hammer. Since we have the hammer, every problem is a nail for us. Just go, okay, do Scrum, you're going to be better. Irrespective of what you do maintenance, you do project, you do something else. No problem, Scrum proved. And we have a lot of graphs. Scrum is working 76%, Scrum is 76% successful, or rather Agile is 76% successful, and Waterfall is 26% successful. So yeah, obviously you should do it. Later, we realized that many things are not falling in place. When we have a coffee discussion with team members, because everywhere we go, when we go and do training, when we talk to people, because it's an idea from the management, nobody opposes, everybody listens. When you have a coffee discussion, when you meet people in the lift, they will really tell you, no, come on, Abin, you came and said Agile is going to solve our problem. Yeah, it created more problems because manager saying, you whatever you are doing, you do it. Your reports you create, the measurement metrics you do, etc., you do it. And you start doing this also. You have a new board, you have a burn down chart, right? And you have a lot of funny new KPIs coming into place, velocity, story point. So far, it's very, very difficult to explain story points to people. So it's a unitless number, come on. Story point, one story point is equal to 0.5 days, 0.75 days. They calculate that way. What can we do? And people are questioned. Your velocity is supposed to, as per the agile notion, your productivity should improve by 5% every iteration. That's the expectation. People are suffering. So that is probably a control question. On the other side, if you are in a collaborative or cultivating environment, probably you can even map companies with that. So do you know any company who does collaboration? Friendly with people, the employees. Some company? Name the company. Your company, wow. What is your company's name? Software?
AG, okay, great. Software AG is a
collaborative company, so Scrum should work for you. Control? Anybody, yeah? Can you name the company?
Catalyst One. And even my company, I work for a bank.
It's pretty controlled because they have a lot of security stuff, right? So no shame, Kanban works for us, so it's okay. And then we talk about craftsmanship, the competence. Probably I can say ThoughtWorks. They're pretty good in XP. They teach people XP. Even we hired some people to teach us XP, right? And cultivation. TCS? Oh, okay. Yeah, a lot of people agree, yes. Okay. So you can try to relate, or you go and ask your people, you just show the diagram and say, hey, how do you rate our project in this? Where do we fall in? Right? People will give you a lot of interesting views. So what we did was, this is roughly the way we mapped with the processes. So the Scrum, when I say Agile, it's Scrum. So Scrum works for these environments. When we see that, even though our company is kind of controlled environment, but some projects are kind of pretty open, collaborative. So we start introducing Scrum for them. And for controlled, by control I mean, you have to keep the WIP limit. You have to control the outcome. So, and you have to follow it pretty strictly. You can't allow people to probably, you know, pull anything and start doing things. Rather, we want to work on the higher priority item in a, you know, more controlled environment. So we introduce Kanban there, and probably hear more on craftsmanship practices, where we will probably craftsmanship go with both, right? It's an engineering practices. And we started introducing continuous delivery now. So it's a long way, right? So this is how we changed our way of looking at things. And now we see that people are a little more happy. Not that they're jumping, but when we see them in Lyft, they say, okay, it was good that you introduced now Scrumban instead of Scrum, which is giving us more perspective about what the product owner does. At least they will know that they're not doing a good job, right? For each column, we introduced definition of done or acceptance criteria, whatever, so that people start thinking about, okay, so I have to complete this to move it here. So we are getting a better visibility, and depending on the culture. So if the culture starts supporting you, then there's a better chance for you to succeed, right? Yes. Exactly. Yes. Yes. Very well. Yeah. So probably if you look at services companies, the customer culture may be the prominent culture for the team, right? Even the company culture may not influence much, but the project culture will change according to the company culture, the client culture. Yeah, of course. Any more questions? No. This is one of the factors. So probably I can't think of all the possible factors, but this is one of the factors which we thought, which is pretty evident, easy to understand, which may be creating a big impact. For example, I had a project manager. I had to deal with a project manager. He never worked on an agile environment. He was kind of waiting to become a manager so that he can control people, he can dictate things, etc. So unless you transform him, no point introducing Scrum in the team, because whatever you do, he'll come back and stand up. He's a chicken. He comes to the stand-up meeting and say, why don't you pick up that, right? So it's going to be difficult. At times, if you are a coach working with the team, and if he comes and does every day, start giving him feedback, probably you'll end up having a debate in front of the people. So, and when people see that whatever you have preached, he's been violated by the manager, then they lose trust in you, right? Yes.
We most of our teams are we hardly have any teams.
Autonomous and located only in one place.
Okay. So how smooth or how easy you are because the moment you have distributed teams, even though it's if you look at it from the entire perspective, it's a single team, but with respect to all these parameters there'll be a lot more difference, right, basically.
So you're talking about the culture
mindset changes with respect to the language barriers.
Language barriers is one aspect, and apart from that, the country culture and the culture of the people also matters a lot. Because in my previous company, I used to work in this distributed environment, and it was really difficult for us to get anything done, because any process we wanted to follow, any metrics we wanted to collect, or any ownership we wanted to take for the action items and the retrospectives and stuff like that, it used to be always 50%, the data used to be 50%, the acceptance of the process is 50%, because the other part they were not interested in taking your data. So even though there was a mandate from the organization, there was kind of push from the top management to ensure that you don't have polymorphic, you are need to follow stuff. See, it was very difficult for us to even introduce something as simple as code reviews.
Yeah.
And unit tests.
Probably, I don't have a single answer. So what normally happens is, as he asked,
the client will have a culture. So that will be, you know, coming to the project team. So the team will form a culture, which is going to be uniform. Even though you work across two different countries, you will form a culture, uniform culture, with respect to these four quadrants, and then that will be your project culture. So you can work around that, not looking at individual culture of your company or individual culture of your locations. So I'll give it. Any more questions?
Take this. Let's take it offline.
Oh yeah, fine, I'm around. Thank you.